Good morning. I want to welcome all of you once again as we gather in the Lord's house. You have perhaps already noticed that we will be following Divine Service Setting 1 on page 151 in your hymnal. And we will open our service as we sing together our opening hymn, the Hymn of Invocation, Hymn 903. This is the day the Lord has made. Congregation will please rise. Again, the order of service on page 151. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. Take a brief moment of silence for reflection on God's word and for self-examination. Let us then confess our sins to God our Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. Have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. If you would turn now to the insert sheet and let us read responsively the introit from Psalm 116 as it is printed. Precious in the sight of the Lord. I love the Lord because he has heard. Because he inclined his ear to me. The snares of death encompassed me. The pangs of Sheol laid hold on me. Then I called on the name of the Lord.
O Lord, I pray, deliver my soul.
For you have delivered my soul from death.
My eyes from tears, my weeping from sorrow.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Precious in the sight of the Lord
is the death of his.
Let us now continue with the Kyrie, which we find on page 152. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
And let us pray. Almighty God, by your great goodness, mercifully look upon your people, that we may be governed and preserved evermore in body and soul, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated. Let us now listen to the word of the Lord. Our Old Testament reading for the fifth Sunday in Lent is from the prophet Ezekiel in the 37th chapter. The hand of the Lord was upon me, and he brought me out in the spirit of the Lord and set me down in the middle of the valley. It was full of bones, and he led me around among them. And behold, there were very many on the surface of the valley, and behold, they were very dry. And he said to me, Son of man, can these bones live? And I answered, O Lord God, you know. Then he said to me, prophesy over these bones and say to them, O dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. Thus says the Lord God to these bones, behold, I will cause breath to enter you, and you shall live. And I will lay sinews upon you, and will cause flesh to come upon you, and cover you with skin, and put breath in you, and you shall live, and you shall know that I am the Lord. So I prophesied as I was commanded. And as I prophesied, there was a sound, and behold, a rattling, and the bones came together, bone to its bone. And I looked, and behold, there were sinews on them, and flesh had come upon them, and skin had covered them, but there was no breath in them. Then he said to me, prophesy to the breath. Prophesy, son of man, and say to the breath, thus says the Lord God, come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe on these slain that they may live. So I prophesied as he commanded me, and the breath came into them, and they lived and stood on their feet, an exceedingly great army. Then he said to me, son of man, these bones are the whole house of Israel. Behold, they say, our bones are dried up and our hope is lost. We are clean cut off. Therefore, prophesy and say to them, thus says the Lord God, behold, I will open your graves and raise you from your graves, O my people, and I will bring you into the land of Israel. And you shall know that I am the Lord when I open your graves and raise you from your graves, O my people. And I will put my spirit within you, and you shall live. And I will place you in your own land. Then you shall know that I am the Lord. I have spoken, and I will do it, declares the Lord. This is the word of the Lord. Our epistle reading for this day is recorded in the book of Romans. We read there in the 8th chapter. There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. For the law of the Spirit of life has set you free in Christ Jesus from the law of sin and death. For God has done what the law, weakened by the flesh, could not do. By sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh and for sin, he condemned sin in the flesh, in order that the righteous requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us, who walk not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. For those who live according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh, but those who live according to the Spirit set their minds on the things of the Spirit. To set the mind on the flesh is death, but to set the mind on the Spirit is life and peace. For the mind that is set on the flesh is hostile to God, for it does not submit to God's law. Indeed, it cannot. Those who are in the flesh cannot please God. You, however, are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if in fact the Spirit of God dwells in you. Anyone who does not have the Spirit of Christ does not belong to him. But if Christ is in you, although the body is dead because of sin, the Spirit is life because of righteousness. If the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ Jesus from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his Spirit who dwells in you. This is the word of the Lord. Please stand. Gospel according to St. John, the 11th chapter. I will be reading just a portion of that which you have in front of you, and then there will be a small addition at the end of that, not printed in your service folder. When Jesus came, he found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb 4 days. Bethany was near Jerusalem, about 2 miles off, and many of the Jews had come to Mary, to Martha and Mary, to console them concerning their brother. So when Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went and met him, but Mary remained seated in the house. Martha said to Jesus, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now I know that whatever you ask from God, God will give you." Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." And Martha said to him, "I know that he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day." Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this?" She said to him, "Yes, Lord. I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, who is coming into the world." Then Jesus, deeply moved again, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone lay against it. Jesus said, "Take away the stone." Martha, the sister of the dead man, said to him, "Lord, by this time there will be an odor, for he has been dead 4 days." Jesus said to her, "Did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God?" So they took away the stone. And Jesus lifted up his eyes and said, "Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I said this on account of the people standing around, that they may believe that you sent me." When he had said these things, he cried out with a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out!" The man who had died came out, his hands and feet bound with linen strips, and his face wrapped with a cloth. Jesus said to them, "Unbind him and let him go." Many of the Jews, therefore, who had come with Mary and had seen what he did, believed in him. But some of them went to the Pharisees and told them what Jesus had done. So the chief priests and the Pharisees gathered the council and said, "What are we to do? For this man performs many signs. If we let him go on like this, everyone will believe in him, and the Romans will come and take away both our place and our nation." But one of them, Caiaphas, who was high priest that year, said to them, "You know nothing at all, nor do you understand that it is better for you that one man should die for the people, not that the whole nation should perish." He did not say this of his own accord, but being high priest that year, he prophesied that Jesus would die for the nation, and not for the nation only, but also to gather into one the children of God who are scattered abroad. So, from that day on, they made plans to put him to death. This is the gospel of the Lord. Please be seated, and we continue with the singing of the hymn of the day, hymn 664. Grace, mercy, and peace be unto you from God our Father, from our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. The text I will direct your attention to is a portion that I read that is not printed on your sheet in the bulletin. Let me read it for you once again, beginning in the 11th chapter of John with verse 47. Then the chief priests and the Pharisees called a meeting of the Sanhedrin. "What are we accomplishing?" they asked. "Here is this man performing many miraculous signs. If we let him go on like this, everyone will believe in him. And then the Romans will come and take away both our place and our nation." Then one of them, named Caiaphas, who was high priest that year, spoke up. "You know nothing at all. You do not realize that it is better for you that one man die for the people than that the whole nation perish." He did not say this on his own, but as high priest that year, he prophesied that Jesus would die for the Jewish nation, and not only for that nation, but also for the scattered children of God, to bring them together and make them one. So from that day on, they plotted to take his life. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, Scripture reveals to us that even before the beginning of time, the Lord had a plan of salvation in mind for all of mankind. And it was a most unique plan, for it would be God himself who would play the key role. The Lord would send a Messiah, a Savior, into the world for man's salvation. And in order to alert mankind to this, God used his prophets through the years to describe in very clear terms how one might be able to recognize that Messiah when he would come. We were told by those prophets that he would be a descendant of King David. He would be born of a virgin, and that birth would take place in the city of Bethlehem. He and his ministry would do great signs and wonders, and he would ultimately suffer and die in order for the salvation plan to be complete. Well, then Scripture records for us that the time was finally right. Everything was in place just as God wanted it to be, and so he sends his only son into the world to be the Savior of mankind. Yes, indeed, now all of those prophecies of old would find their fulfillment in this one whom God would send. There would be no doubt that Jesus of Nazareth was the long-awaited Messiah. Now, in light of those facts, it only makes sense that those who would come to know him as that Messiah would boldly proclaim him, that there would be that message shared with others as to who he was, that they would devote themselves to a ministry of sorts, proclaiming God's truth about the Messiah. All of that, bringing together what the prophecies of old had said about the Messiah. But when we look at identifying and proving in Scripture that indeed Jesus was the one, we certainly would not expect that as part of that salvation plan, God would use the enemies of Jesus to bring things to fruition. Who would have suspected that the God of all creation would put together a salvation plan and then even use the enemies of that Messiah, those who wanted him to be out of the picture completely, that he would use them to serve his purposes? In that text that I just shared with you, we heard that one of Christ's most powerful enemies, a man named Caiaphas, the high priest, is there before us for us to look and to listen. He was the religious leader of God's people, and he should have been the one who would have recognized the Messiah. He should have been the one who would recall all of the Old Testament prophecies, and he would focus on this Jesus of Nazareth, and perhaps check the prophecies against what he saw in this Jesus to decide and determine whether or not this is the one. But that was not his course of action. He really could have cared less about a Messiah coming into the world. He was only concerned about his position. His position in the eyes of the people, his position in relationship to the Roman government. He could have cared less, really, about the coming of a Messiah. And yet it is now this individual that the Lord uses to show us once again that indeed Jesus is all whom he is made up to be by the prophecies of old. The first thing that this group that Caiaphas called together, the Sanhedrin, they proclaim this about this guy, Jesus of Nazareth. What are we accomplishing? Oh, they had been trying to silence him, trying to put him out of the way. But nothing was happening because this guy is performing many miraculous signs. The people are flocking to him as they see him doing his miracles. That should have been something that got their attention in terms of maybe, just maybe, this guy is the Messiah. But in their statement in the text, for you and for me, they are giving further proof that indeed that's exactly who he was. Isaiah prophesied that the Messiah would do many great signs, unbelievable things. And now here we see that even those enemies of Christ, those who hated him, those who wanted him out of the way, they have to admit that this guy's doing miracles again and again. Divine power being evidenced. The glory of God coming out when those miracles were performed. And it was those miracles that so often was the reason that crowds gathered to see Jesus, but it caused the chief priests, the Pharisees, only more to worry about because they were losing their position in the eyes of the people. The people were now going to this Jesus of Nazareth rather than paying attention to the one who was the high priest at that time and the others who thought themselves to be the best of the best. In the people of God, the children of Israel. They were now worried because someone else was becoming the focal point in the minds of people. And so what are they to do? How are we going to overcome this? Obviously, they couldn't do miracles to bring the people to them. But they begin now to think of all the repercussions that might occur. Not only would they lose their position in the eyes of the people, but perhaps Jesus would rise things up so that the people might even think about perhaps rebelling against Rome. And if that's the case, we might lose everything, is the way Caiaphas and his followers were thinking. But now Caiaphas again makes a statement that helps us understand how God's plan of salvation was to be played out. Caiaphas says this, talking to the Sanhedrin who are wondering, what are we going to do? And he says, you know nothing at all. You do not realize that it is better for you that one man die for the people than that the whole nation perish. To Caiaphas, this was a very simple statement that we had to do something about the troublemaker. Let's get rid of him so we don't have any problems with him and we won't get into trouble with Rome. But what he didn't realize is that it was more than just him saying these words. The Lord was using him. And we read this. The text tells us, Caiaphas did not say this on his own. In other words, it wasn't something that was just coming from him. There was someone guiding and directing. As high priest that year, he prophesied that Jesus would die for the Jewish nation. And not only for that nation, but also for the scattered children of God, to bring them together and make them one. Little did Caiaphas realize how God was using him. The one who perhaps hated Jesus more than any other individual of that time is now one whom God is using to proclaim to you and to me to this day that this Jesus was the one. And the plan of salvation was a beautiful one, that one would die. And here we're talking more than just physical death. That he would die in the sense of paying the price of our sins, the sins of the whole world. That he would experience that separation from God as the punishment of man's sin were laid upon him. And he would do this so that all could then be brought together around him. That the message of God's forgiveness would be proclaimed through what Christ had accomplished in coming into our world and giving his life so that we might live and not have to die suffering those same pains of hell because of our sins. The text then concludes with a statement that shows again that God brings things about sometimes in most unique ways. These individuals who were his enemies now have come to the point where they've got to do something. Remember that these words of scripture take place just after the account of the raising of Lazarus. Can you imagine how that community had heard of Lazarus' death? The funeral takes place. He's put in the tomb. He's been in the tomb for 4 days. His sisters are worried when Jesus says, take the stone away, because he's going to smell. It's going to stink. And then he calls him out. Lazarus, come out. And those who were there had to be just unbelievably amazed as here comes this guy walking out wrapped in all the burial garments. And Jesus says, come on, get those off of him. He's not dead. He's alive. And that witness then went throughout the community. Jesus brought Lazarus back to life. And his enemies, Caiaphas, the Sanhedrin, hear about it. And so there's only one thing that they can come up with as a solution. We got to get rid of this guy. And so the text before us concludes with this. From that day on, they plotted to take his life. Now we're going to get rid of him. Somehow we're going to do it. But again, it is God using the enemies of Jesus to bring about the completion of his plan. And we need to recognize that sometimes the world looks terrible, looks like everything is against us, and we may not realize that God can still use those times as well to take care of his purposes and his will. And I would just reference you back to an Old Testament story I'm sure you're all very much aware of, the case of Joseph. His brothers sold him into slavery. Got rid of him. He's gone. We don't have to worry about him anymore. And the text in Scripture says this. Joseph, meeting his brothers, says to them, as for you, you meant evil against me. But God meant it for good, to bring it about that many people should be kept alive as they are today. In all things, who can begin to understand the mysteries of God, how he works in ways so much different than we would think one should have to work? And yet, even when things look the darkest, that bright light of God's revelation to us, of God's grace and mercy to us, ought to bring us to the point where we are trusting in him and his word. What a joy it is to see how God works, that we come to an agreement with ourselves that we will not be, upset about the things of this life when they don't go our way, and to help us get beyond that, to remember God can use the worst of the worst situations of life to bring about the best for those of us who are his. Jesus was greatly abused during his ministry, ultimately put to death, but it had to happen. That was God's plan, to bring you and to me into his kingdom. As the text says, not just the children of Israel, but all nations bringing together around Jesus Christ, that there would be this one people of God reestablished in the world. As their sins are forgiven, they're no longer separated from God, they now are one with him again, as you and I are today, because of God's plan, because of the way God works, sometimes even using the enemies of God, the enemies of you and me, for his purposes. We are in the hands of a gracious and loving God. It's said this way by St. Paul in the book of Romans, as we look at all of the things that can trouble us in this life. And at the end of that, as he has listed them all, he then says this: you guys need to understand this. In spite of all those things that you might be confronted by in everyday life, there is nothing that can separate you from the love of God in Christ Jesus. Not even the enemies can take us away from our loving God. Thanks be to God who reveals to us these truths to help us deal with what we have to face in this world that is still a sinful world. But thanks be to God, he has reached into our hearts and our minds through word and sacrament, made us his own, and promises us that we will spend eternity with him in the heavenly kingdom. God grant that to all of us, and may it cause us to want to share that message. There's a lot of room in heaven, a lot of room that the Lord wants to be filled, and now you and I have the opportunity to be his witnesses, to be his disciples, and take the message of Jesus of Nazareth, the Savior, the Messiah, and all that he has done and all that he has accomplished to our world today. God grant that for Jesus' sake. Amen. And now the peace of God, which surpasses all human understanding, keep your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. I invite you now to stand with me, and let us make a confession of that faith which the Lord has planted within us, using the words of the Nicene Creed found on page 158 in the front of the hymnal. We confess together: I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried. And the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures and ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. We continue now with the prayer of the church. Bidden by our Lord, let us go boldly into his presence with prayers for the whole church and for all people according to their needs. Blessed Lord, your heart has known the pain of grief and the sorrow of death, even as we know it. You entered our world of death to take on the power of death and release those who live in its shadow. Receive our thanks for raising Lazarus from the dead, and direct our eyes to see in this miracle your own resurrection to everlasting life. Comfort us in our sorrows, and help us to grieve not as a people without hope, but as those who anticipate the resurrection of the dead and the life everlasting. Lord, in your mercy. Gracious Lord, you honored the love and care within Lazarus's family, and you know the ties that bind as family, friends, and community. Fill the homes of your people with your spirit and with faith. Bless husbands and wives and lead them to live in faithfulness to their marriage. Bless parents and the children you have placed in their care. Help us to live in love toward you, toward our family, and with our neighbor. Lord, in your mercy. Mighty Lord, you hold all things in your hand, and you know the limitations of our power. Give us good and honest leaders in this and every land. Bless them with wisdom to heed your commands. Honor the path of virtue and punish the wrongdoer. Protect those who protect and defend us, especially the men and women in our armed forces. Guide us so that we may honor the sacred gift of life from conception until the end of this earthly pilgrimage. Lord, in your mercy. Holy Lord, you have called and gathered to you a people through the voice of your word and by the power of your spirit. Give to all your people a strong faith in the face of temptation and doubt and wisdom to discern the truth from error. Provide good and faithful pastors and church workers to serve your people in your name. Bless the churches throughout the world that make common confession with us and serve together in the witness of your word and truth. Lord, in your mercy. Gracious Lord, you know the suffering of your people, and you are present with us in our weakness. Give courage to the sick and those who suffer any need, that they may not waver from the truth. Give to our dry bones your healing grace and spirit, that we may be sustained in the day of trouble and delivered according to your merciful will. Hear us especially for Jim Kuru, Connie Heyerdahl, Harlan Jacket, Judy Huffman, Blaine Vance, Jean Barrent, Nathan Dorst, Doris Hogan, Sandy Lawrence, Patricia Martin, and especially, Lord, the family and friends of Carol Wadeski, and for Jennifer Titus and her family upon the death of her father, Frank Hogan. O gracious God, provide them with the strength and the comfort that you alone can provide. Hear us, Lord, and Lord, in your mercy. Living Lord, you have promised to open the graves and raise your people to everlasting life. As we recall those who have gone before us, we cling to your promise and await the great and blessed day when you shall come in your glory to reunite heaven and earth and to finish your new creation. Until that day, keep us in our baptismal grace and faith, so that we may be found blameless and ready when you come in your glory. Lord, in your mercy. And O most gracious God, we continue to look to you to guide us through our pastoral vacancy. Help us work together to carry out the ministry we share, using our individual talents and abilities that you have given to us. Help our call committee to do all things well that will ultimately lead us to the arrival of our next pastor in your good time. Lord, in your mercy. All these things, Lord, grant us according to your gracious will, keeping from us all things harmful and giving to us only those things which are good and profitable to us and our salvation, until that day when we shall see you face to face and rejoice with Lazarus, Mary, Martha, Ezekiel, and all the saints in your presence forevermore, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please be seated, and we now present our offerings to the Lord. Continue with the service of the sacrament on page 160. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
And let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, Everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who overcame the assaults of the devil and gave his life as a ransom for many, that with cleansed hearts we might be prepared joyfully to celebrate the Paschal feast in sincerity and truth. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying,
Holy, 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 Lord, our Father, and our God, for all of your glory, O Son of God.
Blessed are you, Lord of heaven and earth, for you have had mercy on those whom you created and sent your only begotten Son into our flesh to bear our sin and be our Savior. With repentant joy we receive the salvation accomplished for us by the all-availing sacrifice of his body and his blood on the cross. Gathered in the name and the remembrance of Jesus, we beg you, O Lord, to forgive, renew, and strengthen us with your word and spirit. Grant us faithfully to eat his body and drink his blood as he bids us do in his own testament. Gather us together, we pray, from the ends of the earth to celebrate with all the faithful the marriage feast of the Lamb in his kingdom, which has no end. Graciously receive our prayers. Deliver and preserve us. To you alone, O Father, be all glory, honor, and worship, with the Son and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always. Welcome to the table of the Lord. Take and eat. This is the true body of your Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, given unto death for your sins. Take and drink. This is the true blood of your Lord and Savior, shed for the remission of your sins. May this precious body and blood strengthen and keep you steadfast in the true faith unto life everlasting. Go in peace. Serve the Lord. Amen. Please stand and let us pray. We give thanks to you, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through this salutary gift. And we implore you that of your mercy you would strengthen us through the same, in faith toward you, and in fervent love toward one another. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Receive now the benediction of our most gracious God. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. And the Lord look upon you with his favor and give you his peace. Please be seated and let us close our service singing together hymn 924.